next on Unsolved Mysteries. When a man's nude body is found dumped in the woods, authorities sift through possible motives. A crime of passion, a drug run gone wrong, or a well-planned mafia hit. He was a loving teacher, family man, and a local hero. Now he's on the run, charged with molesting some of his own students. A lonely widower finally meets a woman who seems to be the answer to his prayers. And now she's wanted for his murder. When a U.S. plane was shot down over North Africa during World War II, everyone on board was killed. But one family believes that Airman Sylvan Lazarus survived. And they have a photograph to prove it.
Our team is standing by. Perhaps you can help solve one of our cases. I'm Dennis Farina, and this is Unsolved Mysteries. Join us.
Ohio. A teenager is riding his lawnmower back home from a job when he makes a shocking discovery. A man's body, nude and beaten, dumped on the side of the road. He is identified as Perman Gilbert, a repairman who lived just 7 miles from where the body was found.
The murder of Perman Gilbert shocked everyone in Hamersville. He was easygoing and well-liked. But in this small Ohio town, it wasn't long before words like drug dealers, execution killing, and crime of passion began to be heard.
Perman Gilbert was a loving husband and father of four. His passion was flying his small plane, but he made his living fixing household appliances like washing machines and refrigerators. During the week, Perman worked for a large company, but on Saturdays, he worked for himself and scheduled his own house calls.
When he left that Saturday morning, it was probably 8:30, and he said he didn't want to go. And it just, now it bothers me. That's what I remember about him leaving that morning.
Perman's service calls that Saturday morning took him to Mount Orab, Georgetown, and Aberdeen, Ohio, all small towns within a few miles of his home. When his work was done, Perman crossed the bridge into Maysville, Kentucky. He stopped at a market where a woman named Ann Breeze worked as a cashier. She remembers Perman's visit that day he disappeared.
He was always very neat. Greeted you, you know, very friendly every time you saw him. I never saw the man down or act like he had a care in the world.
When Perman left the market, he walked into the flower shop next door.
There was nothing unusual about him. He was just a normal customer. He wasn't nervous or anything when I met him.
No one knows what happened next. Perman told his wife that he would be back home around 3 that afternoon, but he never showed up.
Then it got to be dark and he wasn't here. It got to be midnight and I was scared. And I was afraid to go out even. I had a small child and I was afraid to put her in the car and go out looking. And then I think about 3 o'clock in the morning, I called one of our friends, and, you know, have you seen Perman? Do you know where he's at? Anything like that. And they didn't.
Joanne Gilbert called the police, but they couldn't turn up any leads. Her husband's body was found the next day. Perman had been shot twice in the chest. Because no cloth fibers were found in the 2 bullet wounds, police believe that Perman was not wearing a shirt when he was killed. His wallet was missing, along with his clothes and his belt. Although Perman's clothes were never found, his van was located the next day, 22 miles from the spot where his body had been discovered.
Herman Gilbert's watch was still hanging on the gear shift lever. His tool box was in there. Parts and supplies was in place in the van. We did do an inspection of the van and recover fingerprints and hair samples. And at this time, we've not been able to match the fingerprints and hair samples to anyone.
The investigation into Perman's murder presented three possible scenarios.
I think that whatever happened to him had something to do with drugs.
Perman often flew his small plane from a rough landing strip on his farm.
Perman told me that he had been approached to fly drugs.
How's it going?
Okay. What's happening?
Well, we have a little favor we'd like to do for us, if you don't mind. Yeah. It's just a little trip.
And all he had to do was to take the airplane and fly it to a certain airport, go in and have a cup of coffee, come back out, and there'd be money laying on the seat or under the seat.
Good money.
You guys don't quit bugging me. I'm going to call the authorities.
And it would have been easy money, but that's against the law, and it was against everything that we believed in.
The second theory involves Perman's brother, Vernon. 3 months before Perman was killed, Vernon Gilbert had agreed to appear before a grand jury. Vernon planned to testify in a case against organized crime.
It should be about an hour or so, okay?
About an hour? Okay.
Perman waited in town while his brother testified. He began to suspect he had been followed that day.
I don't know of any person that might have been following Perman Gilbert, and it was not any of our personnel.
However, Perman's wife believes that he may have been the target of a hired killer.
Maybe my husband knew too much. Maybe Perman was killed to lure his brother back to the funeral, and because they were after him, really. But then his brother didn't come to the funeral.
Police also thought that Perman might have been the victim of a crime of passion.
Thanks for coming over right away.
The very nature of Perman Gilbert's home appliance repair business placed him into many, many households alone with a family member.
Yes, I thought he was very attractive, and I know other women were very attracted to him, too. I feel that the crime of passion theory doesn't hold up, because that's supposed to be something that's very swift, and they beat around on him like someone was trying to get information out of him or something.
What we need now is for someone to come forward and help us trace Perman Gilbert from that flower shop. Anyone that has seen him around the flower shop or in the parking lot with his cream and brown van at that time or later in the day, we'd like to hear from.
I feel like there are people out there in the community that know what happened to my father, and for fear of their own lives or other people, they're afraid to speak up. I wish that they would come forward and fill in those bits and pieces for us to help us find out what happened to my father.
A reward of $20,000 is being offered in this case. If you have any information, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Next, a school teacher and local hero is wanted by police for sexually assaulting his students. Hayward, California. By any measure, Frank Montenegro was a hero. Both of his parents died suddenly when he was 24, leaving behind Frank and five siblings who were all under the age of 18. Frank immediately gave up his carefree life in San Diego and moved back to Hayward to raise his orphan brothers and sisters.
It goes in the first room on the left.
Well, he basically was kind of like an angel that came in there and said, you know, it's going to be all right. You'll stay together and you don't have to worry about being in different places and, you know, not being taken care of.
It wasn't long before the story of Frank's sacrifice became national news.
Did a good job on that book report today.
To support his family, Frank taught special education at the local elementary school.
Good morning, gentlemen.
Known affectionately as Mr. Monty, Frank Montenegro was admired and trusted by virtually everyone.
All right, good.
Then, a mother of a boy in Montenegro's class made a strange discovery.
I noticed in his clothes a new pair of underwear.
Billy?
Yeah.
Whose are these?
They're mine.
And I asked him, where did you get these? And he said, my teacher, Mr. Monty, bought them for me. I thought that was strange. Why would a teacher at school be buying a student underwear?
Just because.
I couldn't really come up with a sensible reason, but I just kind of kept it in the back of my head. And a year after this had happened, my son said, he goes, I forgot to tell you something. And I go, what? And he goes, remember my teacher, Mr. Monty, the one that bought me those underwear and stuff? And I said, yeah, what about him? He said, well, he raped me.
Frank Montenegro seemed to care deeply about children. So police were faced with a troubling dilemma. Was Montenegro the upstanding citizen that he appeared to be, or did he prey upon innocent children?
Messages?
The complaint against Montenegro landed on the desk of Detective Teresa Martinez. She had joined the Fremont Police Department at the age of 22, and 3 years later was a detective assigned to the sexual assault unit.
Frank Montenegro was seen as this huge icon in the community, and you can't ruin somebody's career because one child says it happened. And you can't go into court and convict a guy for child molester sexual assault when there's nothing to corroborate it.
Do you know why you're here today?
Yeah.
So you know about good touch and you know about bad touch?
Yeah.
Detective Martinez had enough experience with children to know that their accounts are not always accurate. So she had to dig deeper into the boy's story. She brought him to a child specialist who questioned the boy further. Martinez watched the interview on a video monitor.
You want to show me on the picture where it touched you?
Right here.
And where do you call that spot?
My private parts.
What came out of that interview is the victim said that all the students in his class had seen what occurred. When we heard that, everybody's opinion was, okay, we know that's not true.
Okay. I really appreciate
Despite her doubts, Martinez interviewed all the children in the boy's class. They all denied seeing anything. She decided to interview the boy again.
Well, I talked to the kids, and not one of them said they saw what happened. Now, I want you to tell me the truth. Did any of those kids see what happened?
This time, the boy admitted that he had lied about the other students seeing the assault. He said that he was scared during the first interview and thought his lie would end the questioning. But he insisted that everything else he said was true. Frank Montenegro had attacked him.
You don't have to believe me, but he did it.
This kid was so believable. His demeanor wasn't one of being untruthful, and you know, he just wasn't lying, and I believed him.
This is Mr. Montenegro's classroom.
Detective Martinez searched Montenegro's classroom, where the victim said the incident took place. She found something that she didn't expect to find at any elementary school. Through a nondescript door were two hidden rooms, separating them, a two-way mirror.
There should be no reason for a two-way mirror between those two rooms. I'm thinking, why would he need that? And in my mind as an investigator, I'm thinking, this guy's probably filming these acts.
This is the computer that I was telling you about. It's pretty nice, isn't it?
The way the two rooms are set up in the back, if Frank wants to do this with this child, he can shut those doors, and even if somebody walked into the classroom, they wouldn't be able to see what was going on.
When Martinez returned the next day, the two-way mirror had been replaced with a regular pane of glass. Fearing that Montenegro might suddenly have become aware of her investigation, Martinez shifted into high gear. She had a search warrant sworn out for Montenegro's home.
And when we searched his room, we found gifts for smaller kids and books about sex with younger kids. Now we're starting to get some things that are going to help me corroborate the profile of a child molester.
Montenegro wasn't home during the search, but a female relative was. Detective Martinez says the relative made a disturbing statement.
Are you here about the little boy in Frankie's room?
I don't know anything about that little boy. Can you tell me more?
She told me of an incident involving another victim that was found in Frank's bedroom naked.
I went to the police about 2 weeks ago. Uh-huh.
After hearing about the possibility of a second incident, Martinez brought Montenegro in for questioning.
It's Billy you're talking about. Is there any reason why Billy would say you're the one that molested him?
I know Billy. He's a liar. He's always telling stories.
Yeah. Why would he lie about something like this?
We talked to him for close to 4 hours, and in that whole time, he never denied that he did anything. It was always, you know, it couldn't have been me. Not, no, I didn't do it. It was more very passive, very, very clear to us that he wasn't being truthful.
You're the one that did this?
But it was still the word of a little boy who had already lied against that of a well-respected teacher. For charges as serious as child abuse, it wasn't enough for an arrest warrant. To seal her case, Detective Martinez needed the testimony from a second victim. She discovered that a neighboring police department held an outstanding complaint against Montenegro involving another boy. Fearing that Montenegro might take off, Martinez raced to the school and pulled the boy out of class for an interview.
So I'm just going to talk to you about Frank a little bit, okay? So why don't we come out over here to the car?
His eyes started tearing up, and he looked as if, oh my gosh, I am caught. I need to talk. I knew that something had happened to that kid.
I want you to be real truthful about what happened.
Detective Martinez said that after gentle questioning, the boy finally revealed the unsettling details of Montenegro's assault.
The stories he told me were probably some of the most horrific stories I'd ever heard. And to even picture in my mind how this guy did these things to this little boy, it made me sick.
Am I in trouble?
No, you're not in trouble at all.
And it broke my heart to see this little kid, who's a great little boy, think that he was bad when he wasn't bad at all.
Mr. Monty?
Martinez now had enough testimony to swear out a warrant for the arrest of Frank Montenegro. But Montenegro was already gone. 6 days after he was interviewed by police, a car rented in his name was found abandoned more than 1,000 miles away in La Paz, Mexico. Montenegro's whereabouts are currently unknown. But police believe that he has likely returned to the United States.
It was hard for me to believe that he did this. I still had a tendency, like everybody else did, to look up to him. My heart has to go out to these children that this has been done to, because their innocence has been taken away from them.
I don't think just because he had a close run-in with the law that would motivate him or scare him to stop his actions. That obsession is still with him wherever he goes. And I hate to think that other kids are going through what my son went through.
Update. An arrest has been made in this case. Here's one of our staff with details.
After 14 years on the run, FBI agents from the Bureau's Fugitive Task Force acted on a tip from the Los Angeles Police Department and tracked Montenegro to Los Angeles, about 450 miles from Hayward. After a foot pursuit and struggle with FBI agents, Montenegro, now 52, was taken into custody. He faces multiple counts of child abuse with a minor.
Next, was Charles Lindbergh the first pilot to fly across the Atlantic? Well, some say that two French pilots made it first. Paris, France, May 21st, 1927. Charles Lindbergh electrified the world by being the first pilot to fly nonstop across the Atlantic Ocean from New York to Paris. Few people realize that roughly 2 weeks before Lindbergh completed his historic flight, two French pilots, Charles Nungesser and Francois Colli, tried to upstage Lindbergh by flying across the Atlantic. Their plane was called the Whitebird. The Whitebird took off from an airfield near Paris on May 8, 1927, and headed for New York. It was last seen by escort planes as it crossed the coast of France and headed out over the vast Atlantic. It was never seen again. Most experts assumed the plane simply crashed at sea. Then, almost 50 years later, Jim Reed, a local hunter, was deep in the Maine woods when he came across something strange.
I saw something that just didn't look right. I thought it was a boulder at first. And then shortly thereafter, I went up and I probed around, and it was an engine, an aircraft engine. Well, I was a mechanic, and it was definitely not a diesel engine or an automobile engine. The cooling element, the way it was built, it indicated to me it was an aircraft engine.
Although Jim was never able to relocate the engine, some believe that he may have stumbled upon the last remains of the Whitebird. Perhaps he had found the elusive proof that the French pilots actually did cross the Atlantic 2 weeks before Charles Lindbergh.
It's very much like trying to assemble a jigsaw puzzle. Little bit by little bit, the pieces come together and make a picture. And we have enough of a picture now to convince us that we're on to the trail.
Rick Gillespie and his wife, Pat Thrasher, are aircraft archaeologists who have been searching for the Whitebird for years. Using an infrared scanner, they flew over the Maine woods where the engine had been sighted. They were looking for traces of metal that might indicate the Whitebird's crash site. But most of their leads came from talking to people. Rick and Pat interviewed longtime Maine residents who claimed to have seen or heard the Whitebird back in 1927.
I was outside, and all of a sudden this plane was overhead.
You heard the aircraft?
I heard the airplane.
Harold Vining believes that he heard the Whitebird on its final flight.
At that time, we was all keyed up, listening for Lindbergh. Due to the fact that this plane was traveling in the wrong direction, it couldn't have been Lindbergh. And I was out chopping wood when I heard this plane go over. And I honestly believe that that's the first plane that I ever heard in my life. That's why it is so outstanding in my mind. Not knowing that it was these French people try and make history, I just paid no attention to it.
It was real foggy for several days. I remember the day well.
Maurice Berry's cousin, Anson, was fishing when he too heard a plane fly over and then heard its engine stop.
Anson said that he heard a ripping crash. I believed the man. I believed what he said. And I fully believe that that airplane is down there somewhere. You just haven't stumbled onto it.
The team searched one of the possible crash sites where the old-timers said they heard the plane. There, they unearthed a strange fragment of wood.
Hey, Pat!
Eventually, Rick and his team found 23 more fragments of the same strip. Together, they formed a length of 2 meters, the exact width of the Whitebird's wing.
We will continue on the project as long as it seems reasonable to do it. What has kept us going in the past has been that new information keeps coming out that corroborates what's come before. And there's very much a feeling of getting closer. Closer.
Since this story aired, the search for the white bird has shifted to the Avalon Peninsula in Newfoundland, Canada. Researchers have found some promising leads, but have yet to come up with the smoking gun, the engine from the white bird.
Coming up, a lonely widower finally meets the perfect woman. Now he's dead, and she's wanted for murder. Bossier City, Louisiana.
Hello? Yeah, I'd like to put an ad in the personals.
On an ordinary summer day, a woman calling herself Diana Ray places an ad in the personal section of a Louisiana newspaper.
I'm honest and hardworking and seeking a compatible single white male, 45 to 55, to enjoy life together.
The woman using the name Diana Ray certainly wasn't the first person to lie in a personal ad. A bit of exaggeration, a few omissions, they're all part of the game. But Miss Ray had something more than romance in mind, and she soon found a target.
Charles Barker was lonely and distraught. He was still grieving the sudden death of his wife of 10 years.
She was killed by a drunk driver. It was a settlement out of court. And he came into a lot of money. But after she died, it just seemed like he kind of fell apart. He didn't know what to do with himself, I think.
He was depressed. But then later on, it's like he snapped out of it and wanted to do things, go fishing and travel. He bought a Winnebago, a boat. I guess that's when the loneliness set in, you know, he didn't like doing them by himself.
A casino on the Red River in Louisiana became Charles Barker's latest diversion. He probably believed that he met Diana by chance, but given her track record, it's likely that it was all a setup.
Is this seat taken?
Well, it is now, isn't it?
It is. I just took it.
Charles Barker carried pretty large amounts of cash with him. She would have almost certainly noticed that because she'd be looking for those kinds of things.
You look like you're doing pretty good over there.
And so he would have become a target for her.
You know what? I might ask you to help me because I'm not doing too good here.
Well, your hand looks pretty good right now. Let's see.
Less than a year after the death of his wife, Charles was swept up in a whirlwind romance with Diana. She moved into his house just days after they met for the first time.
Here we are.
Adorable, I love it.
Well,
Dad told me he'd met a woman in a casino. You know, I didn't think anything of it. You know, I hope he was happy and I don't want to see him alone. You know, I thought maybe she would be a good companion for him. And evidently he was happy with her for a while because he would call me and say he liked her.
You gonna carry me over the threshold?
Well, I'm gonna give it one good old try, I'll tell you that much.
He needed someone, some companionship. He didn't like to be alone.
So you're looking really good, Dad. Tell me about this.
One weekend, Jennifer made the 9-hour drive from her Austin, Texas home to meet her father's new girlfriend.
Hey, sugar, I'm all out of ammo.
Oh, hon, Deanna, I want you to meet my daughter, Jennifer.
Oh, hi.
Jennifer, Deanna.
Nice to meet you. So are you from around here?
I'm from all around.
She wasn't very, you know, a real presentable woman. You know, just no class.
Okay, it's nice to meet you. It's nice to meet you.
She looked like a barfly, you know. I was suspicious of her. I knew she wasn't right for him.
Daddy, what's going on?
A short time later, even Charles apparently began to think the same thing.
One big old messy situation here.
According to his daughter, Cindy, Charles admitted he was having trouble with Diana, but refused to provide any details.
Next week we'll get together, I promise you, and I'll sit down with you and I'll tell you everything.
When my dad called me, he just sounded so different, and he started crying, and I've never, you know, heard my dad cry or anything.
I can
but he told me he'd call me in 2 or 3 days, everything would be okay, and let me know what was going on.
But that call never came. Jennifer tried to get in touch with her father to arrange another visit.
I'd been trying to phone him for the whole week, and no answer. And I finally called my aunt. And she said, we'll go by there and check on him.
Unbelievable.
Charles' sister June and her husband drove over to see if there was a problem.
Charlie?
June Stringer and her husband notice that the front door of the residence is open. So they proceed further. The husband looks in and sees Mr. Barker slumped over the bar.
Charles had been dead for 5 days, killed by a single gunshot wound to the head. As police worked the crime scene, they made several observations.
Our detectives found no sign of a struggle. They did not find a house that had been ransacked. Mr. Barker had a 25 caliber Raven arms pistol that he kept in his residence. There were no prints found on the gun, but the ballistics evidence indicates that that was the weapon that was used. Mr. Barker had a safe that he kept in his bedroom. The safe was opened when investigators arrived.
Except for a few stocks and bonds, the safe was empty.
I know for a fact that my dad always kept money in there. And at that time, I believe he probably had $45,000 at least in that safe.
Charles Barker's Lincoln Town car was missing, and so was his girlfriend, who authorities soon identified as a con artist named Hazel Head.
Mr. Barker's vehicle was found the next day after his body was discovered. It was found near the airport. Inside the car were pieces of clothing that belonged to Hazel. Also found in the car was DNA evidence, physical evidence that we believe definitely links her to the car. We believe she is the one that took the car from his residence and drove it to that spot near the airport.
A background check on Hazel Head revealed that she'd married as many as 10 times and was known to use more than a dozen aliases. There was also an outstanding warrant for her arrest in Lincoln, Nebraska. There, she had allegedly burned down her boyfriend's home and then fled before standing trial. Did Hazel Head murder Charles Barker and escape with all of his cash? Had this been her plan from the very beginning?
Our investigators theorized that Mr. Barker was probably at the bar reading the newspaper. Hazel came out of the bedroom with the gun, the 25 caliber. He didn't realize that she was behind him. We believe that Mr. Barker probably never knew what hit him.
Hazel Head is known to frequent truck stops, often hitching rides from town to town. She is 5 feet 2 inches and has a scar near her right eye and a gap in her front teeth. She is wanted for the first degree murder of Charles Barker and should be considered dangerous. If you have any information about this case, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Coming up, a family search for a young airman lost during World War II. Greenville, Tennessee. In the summer of 1924, sharecropper Rufus Hinkle was forced to make an agonizing decision. His wife had died after giving birth to twin girls, Mary and Martha. With little money and 9 other mouths to feed, Rufus was forced to put the twins up for adoption. Within a few months, Mary and Martha were adopted by separate families. Rufus never saw his daughters again. He died in 1950. We call
her Mary. Later on, I heard that they would not tell us where they were at until my father died. So shortly after he died, we started looking for the twins and we found Mary.
In September of 1955, Shorty and Mary were reunited at her home in Bluefield, West Virginia. That afternoon, Mary received a special surprise.
Mary, I've got some news for you. You have a twin sister named Martha.
Really?
Really.
I just don't kind of explain how I did feel. not knowing that I had a twin sister, a part of me.
However, Martha's whereabouts remained a mystery.
I've often wondered if it's been good or if Martha's life has been bad. You wonder about them things.
Update. Shortly after we broadcast this story, one of our viewers came forward with information about Mary's twin sister, Martha Hinkle. Martha had been raised by the Dan Jackson family of Johnson County, Georgia. In 1940, she married James Thomas. These are their four sons. But Martha herself passed away weeks before this story went on the air.
I'm glad that I found her. We won't have to do no more searching. But it's so sad that I couldn't meet her, that I couldn't be with her just to talk to her just for an hour or two and tell her that I loved her.
Although Mary Carter never met her twin sister, she did find Martha's extended family. At a bittersweet reunion, the two families finally came together as one. As World War II raged in Europe, an American B-24 took off from Morocco in North Africa on a non-combat mission. For reasons that have still not been explained, it crashed into a mountainside. The entire crew was lost. Among the victims were three airmen, Sylvan Lazarus, Carl Cobb, and Bernard Brady. For more than 50 years, they have been the center of a perplexing mystery. 3 months after the crash, a Baltimore newspaper ran this photograph of a German officer interrogating four American POWs. Three of them were identified by their families as Lazarus, Cobb, and Brady. The winter of 1943 was an anxious time for the Lazarus family. On December 14th, they learned that their oldest son, Sylvan, was missing in action. 3 weeks later, their worst nightmare became reality.
Dad?
It's your brother. He's dead.
At the time, Sylvan's brother, Arnold, was 17 years old.
We were devastated, absolutely devastated. I mean, my brother was such a great guy. He was loved by everybody, very, very outgoing, family-oriented. And to lose somebody like that it's devastating. There's no other word I could use.
According to the official report, on December 8th, 1943, Sylvan and 13 other men boarded the B-24 on the east coast of Africa. The plane was bound for Casablanca in Morocco. It went down in the rugged Atlas Mountains. The report concluded that Lazarus, Cobb, and Brady were all buried with the rest of the crew in a mass grave. As the months went by, the Lazarus family tried to cope with the loss of Sylvan. And then, on March 17, 1944, the mysterious photograph appeared in the Baltimore Mirror.
Anna! Anna!
Their grief turned to confusion, then to hope.
As prisoners of Germany captured after their planes were shot down over the...
We were shocked. I mean, there was no question about it that one of the airmen was definitely my brother. His eyes, his posture, the way he stood at a certain way, was definitely him, definitely.
The family began to wonder if Sylvan had survived, but the photo was confusing. The prisoners were supposedly being interrogated by a Nazi officer in North Africa, but the Germans had been driven from Morocco 7 months before the crash. Sylvan's father was convinced that there was much more to the story. He got the names of the 13 other airmen killed in the crash and sent a copy of the photo to each family. Bernard Brady of New York and Carl Cobb of Cynthiana, Kentucky, were identified in the photo by their families.
My father wanted more answers, and he wrote back and forth to the government. My father even contacted the Red Cross, trying to get answers. But it was all in vain.
The Lazarus family now believes that Sylvan's plane may have been shot down during a secret mission behind German lines in Europe, not in Africa. They also believe that some of the crewmen managed to parachute to safety, only to be taken prisoner by the Nazis. Sylvan, Cobb, and Brady could have been photographed while being interrogated about their mission. The Lazarus family fears that Sylvan may have been singled out because of his ethnic heritage.
My theory is the Germans found out that my brother was Jewish. And I believe that they violated the Geneva Convention. By rights, he should have been put into a POW camp. But I don't believe that that happened. I believe that he was put into a concentration camp instead.
Although it has been more than 60 years since Sylvan Lazarus was last seen alive, his family continues to search for clues to his fate.
Having seen the photograph, we cannot help but wonder what really happened to him. Couldn't have been killed in a crash. So what happened to him? That's what we want to find out.
Update. Shortly after this story aired, a viewer called to report that he was one of the rescue workers who responded to the crash of the B-24 in the Atlas Mountains of North Africa. He spoke by telephone to the missing airman's brother, Arnold Lazarus, and told him that the plane had struck the mountain with such force that no one could have survived the impact. Before he passed away, Arnold Lazarus realized that the man in the photo was not his brother Sylvan. It was, in fact, a case of mistaken identity.